हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा।
हे राधा माधव कुंज विहारी, माधव कुंज विहारी, गोपी जन वल्लभा गिरिवर धारी, गोपी जन वल्लभा गिरिवर धारी, यशोद नंदन ब्रज जन रंजन, यशोद नंदन ब्रज जन रंजन, यमुना तीरा वनचारी, यमुना तीरा यमुना तीरा वनचारी, जय राधा माधव कुंज विहारी, माधव जय राधा माधव कुंज विहारी, गोपी जन वल्लभा गिरिवर धारी, जय गोपी जन वल्लभा गिरिवर धारी, जय राधा माधव कुंज विहारी, यशोद नंदन ब्रज जन रंजन, यशोद नंदन यशोद नंदन जय ब्रज जन रंजन, यशोद नंदन जय ब्रज जन रंजन, यमुना तीरा वनचारी, यमुना तीरा वनचारी, यमुना तीरा वनचारी, हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे, हरि हरि हरि, हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे, हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे, हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा हरे कृष्णा हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम हरे राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम हरे राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम हरे राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे जय जगन्नाथ जय बलदेवा सुभद्रा माई जय सुदर्शना जय 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 प्रभुपाद 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 जय जय प्रभुपाद निताय गौर हरि बोल हरि बोल निताय गौर हरि बोल जय विष्णुपाद परमहंस परिराजकाचार्य अष्टोत्तर सिद्ध श्री श्री श्रीमद अभय चरणारविंद भक्ति वेदांत स्वामी श्रील प्रभुपाद की नामाचार्य श्रील हरिदास ठाकुर की जय ग्रंथराज श्रीमद् भागवतम की सामवेद गौर भक्तवृंद की हरे कृष्णा सो टुडे वी आर रीडिंग फ्रॉम श्रीमद् भागवतम कैंटो वन एंटाइटल्ड एज अ क्रिएशन चैप्टर नंबर टू एंटाइटल्ड एज डिविनिटी एंड डिवोशन डिवाइन सर्विस श्लोक नंबर 27 So before reciting the shloka, let's have a prayers, short prayers. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। नारायणं नमस्कृत्यं नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जायमुदीरये नष्टप्रायेषु अभद्रेषु नित्यं भागवत सेवया भगवते उत्तम श्लोके भक्तिर्भवति नैष्ठिकी। कृष्णाय वासुदेवाय देवकी नंदनाय च नंदगोपकुमाराय गोविंदाय नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौरभक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। श्लोक नंबर 27 फ्रॉम फर्स्ट कैंटो सेकंड चैप्टर, प्लीज रिपीट आफ्टर मी। रजस्तमा प्रकृत्यः रजस्तमः प्रकृत्याः समाशीला भजन्ति वै पितृभूता प्रजेदा साधिन् पितृभूता प्रजे साधिन् श्री ऐश्वर्या प्रजेप्सवा श्रेय श्रीयाश्वर्या प्रजेप्सया। रजस्तमा प्रकृत्याया समशीला भजन्ति वै पितृभूता प्रजेशादिन् श्रेयैश्वर्या प्रजेप्सवा रजस्तमः प्राकृत्याया समशीला भजन्ति वै पितृभूता प्रजेस्वादिन् श्रेयैश्वर्या प्रजेप्सवा। प्लीज रिपीट। रजस्तमा प्रकृत्याया समशीला भजन्ति वै पितृभूतां साधिन् श्रीयैश्वर्या प्रजेप्सवा। रजस्तमः प्रकृत्याः समशीला भजन्ति वै पितृभूता प्रजेसादिन् श्रीयैश्वर्या प्रजेप्सवा। रजस्तमः प्रकृत्याः समशीला भजन्ति वै पितृभूता प्रजेसादिन् श्रीयैश्वर्या प्रजेप्सवा। रजस्तमः प्रकृत्याः समशीला भजन्ति वै पितृभूता प्रजेसादिन् श्रीयैश्वर्या प्रजेप्सवा। वर्ड टू वर्ड मीनिंग। रजः द मोड ऑफ पैशन, तमः द मोड ऑफ इग्नोरेंस, प्रकृतया ऑफ दैट मेंटालिटी, समशीलः ऑफ द सेम कैटेगरीज, भजन्ति डू वर्शिप, वाय एक्चुअली पितृ the four fathers, bhuta other living beings, prajesha adin controllers of cosmic administration, shriya enrichment, aishwarya wealth and power, praja progeny, ipsavaha so desiring। ट्रांसलेशन एंड परपोर्ट बाय हिज डिवाइन ग्रेस A.C. भक्तिवेदांत स्वामी श्रील प्रभुपाद। श्रील प्रभुपाद की जय। ट्रांसलेशन। दोज हु आर इन मोड ऑफ पैशन एंड इग्नोरेंस वर्शिप दोज इन द सेम कैटेगरी, नेमली द फोर फादर्स, अदर लिविंग बीइंग्स एंड द डेमी गॉड्स हु आर इन चार्ज ऑफ कॉस्मिक एक्टिविटीज। for they are urged by a desire to be materially benefited with woman, wealth, power and progeny. Please repeat the translation responsibly behind me. Those who are in the mode of passion and ignorance worship those in the same category, namely the forefathers, other living beings, and the demigods, who are in charge of cosmic activities. For they are urged by a desire to be materially benefited with woman, wealth, power, and progeny. Purport. There is no need to worship demigods of whatsoever category if one is serious about going back home, back to Godhead. In the Bhagavad Gita 7.20 and 23, it is clearly said that those who are mad after material enjoyment approach the different demigods for temporary benefits, which are meant for men with a poor fund of knowledge. We should never desire to increase the depth of material enjoyment. Material enjoyment should be accepted only up to the point of the bare necessities of life and not more or less than that. To accept more material enjoyment means to bind oneself more and more to the miseries of material existence. More wealth, more women, and false aristocracy are some of the demands of the materially disposed man, because he has no information of the benefit derived from Vishnu worship. By Vishnu worship, one can derive benefit in this life as well as life after death. Forgetting these principles, foolish people who are after more wealth and more wives and more children worship various demigods. The aim of life is to end the miseries of life and not to increase them. For material enjoyment, there is no need to approach the demigods. The demigods are but servants of the Lord. As such, they are duty bound to supply the necessities of life in the form of the water, light, air, etc. One should work and worship the Supreme Lord by the fruits of one's hard labor for existence, and that should be the motto of life. One should be careful to execute occupational service with faith in God and in proper way, and that will lead one gradually on the progressive march back to Godhead. Lord Sri Krishna, when he was personally present at the Vrajadham, stopped the worship of the demigod Indra and advised the residents of Vraja to worship by their business and to have a faith in God. Worshipping the multi-demigods for material gain is practically a perversity of religion. This sort of religious activity has been condemned in the very beginning of Srimad Bhagavatam as Kaitava Dharma. There is only one religion in the world to be followed by one and all, and that is the Bhagavata Dharma, or the religion which teaches one to worship the Supreme Personality of Godhead and no one else. Om Ajnanatimirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। श्री चैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपा कदामय्यं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकं। वन्देहं श्रीगुरो श्रीयुतापदकमलं श्रीगुरुन् वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं सागरजातं सहगना रघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजना सहितं श्रीकृष्ण चैतन्य देवं श्रीराधा कृष्ण पादान सहगना ललिता श्री विशाखान्वितं च नमः विष्णुपादाय कृष्णपृष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देश तारिणे जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे। हरे कृष्णा। वी आर रीडिंग फ्रॉम श्रीमद् भागवतम एज वी आर डिस्कसिंग डेली एंड श्रीमद् भागवतम द श्लोकास टुडे आल्सो आई हैव अटेम्प्टेड टू प्रेजेंट समथिंग ऑन दिस ग्लोरियस श्रीमद् भागवतम। दिस श्रीमद् भागवतम इट क्रिएट्स अ रेवल्यूशन इन द मिसडायरेक्टेड लाइव्स। दिस कैन डायरेक्ट अस टू राइट डायरेक्शन as we have many branched in the world, people are in many, they have many aims in their life, many goals in their life. But Srimad Bhagavatam gives a right direction where to focus. It rejects whatever is unnecessary, it guides, it keeps us in a track where we can progress in our life. In that way, Srimad Bhagavatam is a glorious scriptures. One of the Srimad Bhagavatam is considered as Amala Purana. So I pray and seek blessings from this Granth Bhagavat and Person Bhagavat, His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada and all the Vaishnava Acharyas, Sri Sri Jagannath Baladeva Subhadra, to bless me so that I can speak some words and glorifying Srimad Bhagavatam, which can help me in improving my sincerity in practice, and it can also inspire the audience who are hearing this message. Hare Krishna. So in my 7th class or 8th class around, I used to watch a TV channel, the news, good news, channel name is Good News. Every day morning, they used to come up with the good news. But if you start any news channel, we will have all the, of course, bad news. But when we see this channel, especially Good News, they present good news. They speak from literally Bible. They, every day, they speak something from Bible, the good words, good message. So I used to watch in my 8th class or 9th class, around like that. Then afterwards, I shifted my channels to, you know, Hindu religious TV channels. So this Srimad Bhagavatam, Srila Prabhupada has insisted and kept this in the institution to hear every day morning, so that we relish what we are practicing and we can get inspired to hear this great news, the glorious news of Srimad Bhagavatam. Yes. So there are some points which are mentioned in the purport. I will highlight that and I will show some PPT on the basic concept of demigod worship, which is the core main theme of this shloka. So this is the main line here, one line. One should work hard and worship. One should work hard and worship the Supreme Lord by the fruits of one's hard labor for existence, and that should be the motto of life. So generally, materialistic people, this is the main motto for their life. Work hard, get the results and live the life. Work hard, get the results and live the life. This is what the main materialistic people motto is. And in this struggling for existence, they have many, many material desires which they want to fulfill. For that, they work hard and they get the results, they enjoy the life, they go on in their lives. But Prabhupada says, one should be careful in executing these duties. We have seen this shloka where if we don't please the Supreme Lord Adokshaja, Vishnu, all our material hard labor is just a shrama evahi kevalam. It is a useless attempt to work hard and get the results. So the purpose again, Srimad Bhagavatam focuses, it is not just working hard and getting the results, but for what purpose you are working. that is directing towards the Supreme Lord. And the Srimad Bhagavatam, in the third shloka of Srimad Bhagavatam, Dharma Projita Kaitabotra Parama Nirmatsaranam Satam Vedyam Vastavam Atra Vastu Shivadam Tapatrayon Mulanam. The Srimad Bhagavatam rejects the false conception of Dharma, the false conception of religion. That is called Kaitabha Dharma. It rejects it and it establishes the what is the true meaning of religion. And there is only one religion in the world that is followed by one and all, and that is Srimad Bhagavad Dharma, or the religion which teaches one to worship the Supreme Personality of Godhead and no one else. That is Srimad Bhagavad Dharma. That is what Srimad Bhagavatam presents. The famous Acharya, Shankaracharya, he says in the Gita Mahatya, Ekam Shastram Devaki Putra Gitam Eko Devo Ekam Deva Devaki Putra Eva Eko Tasya Karman Eko Namani Eko Mantras Tasya Namani Yani Karma Bhi Ekam Tasya Devasya Seva. Shankaracharya keeps this very four lines in a shloka very systematically. Everybody wants one religion, everybody wants one God, everybody wants to focus on one work. Shankaracharya gives a clear directive for that, saying, let there be only one God, that is Devaki Putra Eva, son of Devaki. Let there be only one scripture, that is Devaki, whatever spoken by Devaki Putra, Devaki Putra Gita, which is Bhagavad Gita. And he also says, let there be only one mantra. In the Vedas, there are so many mantras which are mentioned. There is only one mantra, which is Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, which Shankaracharya recommends. And let there be only one work, which is Seva, service to the Supreme Lord Sri Krishna. Tasya Devasya Seva, that Supreme Lord service. So in this way, Srimad Bhagavatam gives us a clear directive where we can focus in our practice, in our living. So this 1.2.26 and 27, these two shlokas discusses about the demigod worship and the monists who are looking for the liberation. In the 26th shloka, we have seen people who are aspiring to get liberated, mukti, they don't worship demigods, even though they have some respect towards demigods. They don't hate demigods, but they don't worship demigods. But they worship Mukunda, who is a giver of liberation. In the 26th shloka, we have seen this. Mumukshu, the people who are aspiring to get liberation, mukti, they worship Vishnu, who is a mukti pradata, Krishna. And today's shloka, 27th shloka, it explains, people who are in mode of passion and ignorance, they worship people who are in same category. Because they are, they have a great aspirations to get a material, fulfill their material desires, like woman, wealth, and power, and progeny, like that. This is a standard of a whole human society. Everybody wants to fulfill their desires, named as WWW. Wealth, woman, wine. Many people, they are interested in these three things. So that's how they have a rampant, their practices, their activities are so much. The main purpose of their life is to fulfill their desires in terms of getting a beautiful woman, enjoying, having a luxurious wealth, having all the facilities in their life and having a nice intoxications where they will get higher taste in their life. That were the standard for the whole human society. For such kind of people, definitely they are engrossed in the three modes of material nature, sattva, rajas, tama. And these people, they worship, they glorify the people who are in the same modes. For example, if somebody is interested in singing, he will choose someone in that field, the best singer, and he glorifies him. He walks around him, he spends his time with him, his whole goal is to become such kind of leading singer. If somebody is interested in politics, his main inspirational character, inspirational personality is someone in the politics. Similarly, person who is in mode of ignorance, he glorifies, he takes inspiration from a person who is in the mode of ignorance. Similarly, person who is in mode of passion, he takes inspiration, he glorifies, he spends his time to a person who is in mode of passion. Yes? Is it clear? This concept is very clear. So person glorifies the person who is on his same level, you know, in his same interest. Now, if you see, these all the demigods and the Pitrus, the forefathers and the Bhutas, who are ghostly bodies, they also have some capacity to fulfill the desires of someone else. For example, if you see, if somebody wants to get a good job in some corporate company like Infosys or some corporate company, you want to get job, definitely he will associate with such kind of person. He understands and he works and he asks for the help. Arey, please recommend me for the job. There are many jobs also which happens through recommendations. So that the higher official authority, he recommends him to get into job. Even a materialistic person who is in some corporate company, he has a power to fulfill some benedictions, fulfill some desires of the person. Even a materialistic person has that. On higher level, even the demigods, bhutas, they also have a capacity to fulfill the desires of someone. Even the demigods have that. They may not fulfill the desires which are not on their level. For example, if you see, Hiranyakashipu was performing a lot of austerities in his life. A lot of austerities he was performing. He was performing so much so that the fire which is emanating from his body is shaking whole three worlds. Even the Indra, Chandra, they were fearing. What is this? The vapors, you know, the heat sensation is coming to them. They got shocked and they went to Brahma. Please do something. There is some person, Hiranyakashipu, is doing a lot of austerities, tapasya. Do something. Then Brahma appears and asks Hiranyakashipu, tell me what you want. Then Hiranyakashipu asks, please, I want a boon that I should become immortal. I should never die. Brahma says, sorry, even I am entangled in birth, death, old age, disease. Even I am entangled. I cannot give you immortal because I am also a mortal being, Brahma saying. Even Indra, Chandra, they are also mortal beings. All these demigods are mortal. Just because they drank Amruta doesn't mean that they became immortals. Even though they drank Amruta, one day they will have to change their post. They have to change their body. Means they have to die one day. So they cannot give a results, they cannot give any boons to those who are aspiring from them, which are not on their level. So that's why Srimad Bhagavatam, which rejects worship of demigods, worship of bhutas, pretas. That's why Srimad Bhagavatam rejects this Kaitava Dharma. it rejects Kaitava Dharma. So many times we have understanding 33 crores of demigods, right? Yes? Can anybody name the 33 crore of the demigods? It is very difficult. We cannot. Yes? Can anybody try? It's very difficult. So, another way, the same Vedic literature, they give a meaning of 33 crore of 33 types. They give 33 types of demigods they give. The meaning of crore in crore in Sanskrit, there is also meaning of type. And also there is a 33 crore. There are different meanings for it. So, to understand who are the demigods is very difficult for us. We have not seen them. We have not dealt with them. But we have seen people who are semi-gods. There is another word called semi-gods. These semi-gods are those who are very popular in the material world. In the universe, they are very attractive and very wealth. They have full of wealth and they are opulent and they are famous. For example, if you see in a Bollywood, there are some semi-gods. They are not demigods, they are semi-gods. People who worship them, even in politics, there are some semi-gods. People who worship them, build temples for them, build statues for them in the cross signals. They also inspire some people. If you see Narendra Modi, he is a very wonderful, charming politician. Many people take inspiration from him. How Chaiwala became great Prime Minister of India. They take nice inspiration from them. These are people called semi-gods. Even in Bollywood, if you take some people names, there are many very popular. Yes, they are very popular. And many people follow them. People, whatever, he just, if that Bollywood actor, if he smokes cigarette in a rounds and rounds and rounds, if he gives a smoke, all his followers follow it. If some, any Tollywood actor wears some special pant, and all his followers, all his fans follow it. So we have understanding of semi-gods. We have seen them. We have dealt with them. We have seen their things, daily life. But we have not dealt with the demigods. But these demigods are actually empowered members of the universal government by Krishna, by the Supreme Lord. So because we don't have any interaction with them, we may not be knowing much about them. But definitely they are empowered people, not the semi-gods. Semi-gods also may be empowered, but within this material realm. They cannot help they cannot fulfill the desires of some in some extent. They can only do in some level. So if you see demigod worship, Srimad Bhagavatam condemns this. It says, Akela Ishwara Krishna Arasabha Bhrithya. Only the Supreme Lord is Sri Krishna. Everyone else is a servant of Sri Krishna. It says, Bhakti is only performed for Bhagavan. Nowadays, there is a concept called Desha Bhakti. Yes? But Desha Bhakti, service to Desha, nation, is not considered as a Bhakti. Bhakti is only considered when we serve, glorify Bhagavan. Not for Desha, not for semi-god, not for demigod. Okay? So Bhakti is not, there is no Ganesh Bhakti, there is no Brahma Bhakti, there is no Kumara Bhakti, there is no Bhakti kind of. Bhakti means which is rendered a service for Bhagavan. Bhakti is only performed for Bhagavan. So there is a wonderful shloka in 7th chapter, 20th shloka, it says, can somebody recite this shloka loudly?
Kamaste ste hrita jnana prapadyante anya devatah tam tam niyamamastaya prakritya niyatasvaya.
So this shloka says, Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, people worship demigods. He is presenting the facts. Yes, people worship demigods. Some people also worship semigods. Some people worship their Pitru Devatas. Yes.
Krishna is making this point clear. Why they worship? From the shloka. Their hrita jnana. Because they have materially inclined desires. Such kind of desires they have. That's why they worship demigods or semi-gods or any, you know, mostly popular, wealthiest, attractive personality in the world. Prapadyanti anya devata. They go for different demigods. Krishna is telling this. Anya devataha. Tam tam niyamata niyata niyamam astaya prakritya niyata svaya. So tam tam niyamam astaya. Krishna is also making this point. They worship certain kind of demigod in which they are very comfortable with. Their prakriti suitable for it. For example, it means prakritya niyata svaya means a person who is in mode of goodness, they will worship demigod who is in mode of goodness. A person will worship who is in mode of passion, he will worship a demigod or semigod, whoever it may be, who is in mode of passion. So this is a translation. Those whose intelligence has been stolen by material desires, yes, they have full of material desires. Their intelligence stolen. Surrender unto demigods and follow the particular rules and regulations of worship according to their natures. That nature refers to modes, goodness, passion, and ignorance. One place Krishna says, it is 23, he says, Antavantu phalam tesham, tad bhavati alpa medasam, devan deva yajo yanti, mad bhakta yanti mamapi. So people, they have material desires, but the problem is, they have temporary results. They work, but these results are temporary. For example, a person who wants to become famous. Yes, he wants to become famous. He will worship some demigod and he will become famous. It is not that he will not become. He will become famous by the mercy of that demigod. But that becoming famous is temporary. By the end of the time, end of the death, by the death, his famous is no more is there. He is a famous, but after next life, he is no more famous. He is again A, B, C, D. From childhood again he lives. Somebody who is desiring for money, wealth, he worships certain kind of demigod and he gets wealth. But this wealth is not permanent. It is a temporary asset. That's why it is said, Antavanta phalam tesham. The result which they get from the demigods is have some limits. It stays for only for some time. That's why they are considered as alpamedasam. People who go for temporary results, they are considered as alpamedasam. Other place, because they look for quick results. Nowadays, everybody wants something quick. Yes? They want instant gulab jamun. Just no need to work hard. Just get the powder, add it in milk, make the balls, throw in the oil, we'll get a gulab jamun. Instant gulab jamun. And they want fast food. We no need to get the grains and husk it, get the grains and make a wash in water, keep on a stove, get it boiled and rice will prepare. No. We want everything instantly. We have fast foods. The fast food is something which goes fast and comes out fast. That is the problem. These people, they are looking for quick results. That's why they are called as abuddhaya. Avyaktam vyakti mapannam manyate mam abuddhaya param bhavam ajananto mamai vayam anuttamam. These people, they always consider, they want something very quick. That's why they are also mentioned as abuddhaya. So let's see some effect analysis of demigod worship and Krishna's worship, Supreme Lord worship. Effect analysis, what will happen? So we have seen this. If we worship demigods, it is a temporary effect. It doesn't really solve our problems. For example, a child got a boil on a body. That is troubling him a lot. It is oozing, there is not a lot of itching sensation. And the boil is just paining a lot. When he goes to doctor, know, when he goes to doctor, he goes to doctor, one kind of doctor, he goes and sees allopathy, homeopathy, he goes to a doctor, he says, okay, this is a small boil, no problem, I will give an ointment, you apply it in an ointment, it will go. So that boy, he took the ointment, he applied, boil went. He is very happy, boil went. But after few days, some other place, the same boil appear again. Then he goes to again the same doctor, he says, he will give the same ointment, apply it, it will go. It went. Again the same boil comes on a different place in the body. So now, the doctors, they see the allopathy, homeopathy, as per, you know, understanding. They may see results, they may give ointment, results, they may give a medicine, which just quick medicine, which relieves you immediately, right now. But when we approach Ayurvedic, which solves from the core of the problems, which identifies what is the core of the, what is the core reason of the problem, the Ayurvedic doctor may say, so this is a problem of blood. Actually, blood is not pure. That's why you are getting a boil in different places. So he gives some medicine which purifies the blood. So when we go to demigods to fulfill our desires, they will give definitely results. They will give some relievers from the problems. But that is a temporary effect. Boil will come somewhere else again. But when we, you know, worship Krishna, that has a permanent effect. The Supreme Lord, he fulfills the desires. At the same time, he takes out the root cause of the desire, the material desire, he takes out it. Bhagavatam gives a nice analogy. When we burn dry leaves, dry plants, only dry leaves and branches may get burned. But the roots will remain same in the ground. But same Bhagavatam explains, when we worship Krishna, the roots of that tree is also removed. Nowadays, people do a lot of mistakes, a lot of sinful activities. They go to jail, they take 2 years, 5 years jail period, and they come back and they commit same mistakes again. Same sinful activities again. But when we worship Krishna, he takes out the root cause of the material desire. That purifies really. That gives a permanent effect. So in demigod worship, people are there in mode of goodness also. People are there in mode of passion and ignorance. These people worship so-and-so demigods, whoever is respectively in that mode. And whoever takes care of that mode. For example, mode of goodness, this person, he wants to achieve the heavenly planets. He wants to enjoy the heavenly planets. And mode of person in mode of passion, he wants to become a powerful leader. He wants to rule and manage and control. Person in mode of ignorance, he is looking for a gross sense gratification. He completely wants to fulfill his material desires, gross material desires. So he will worship so-and-so demigod along according to the modes. But bhakti, which gives a Krishna, bhakti means, we should understand, bhakti is only performed for Bhagavan, not for anyone else. Krishna. Worshipping Krishna, which gives a permanent effect, which purifies the heart from all the modes of material nature. It elevates us from the modes of material nature. And it purifies us. So bhakti is above the mode of three modes of material nature. It is not under the modes of material nature. It is not under the duality. The Krishna consciousness is not under the three modes. That's why when we practice Krishna consciousness, we get elevated from the good ignorance to passion, passion to goodness, goodness to Shuddha Sattva. So that is the benefit of practicing Krishna consciousness. And Krishna consciousness is not a good, either not a bad. Krishna consciousness is actually a best thing. Krishna is not suggesting Arjuna to do something good and be good and do good. No. Krishna is suggesting in Gita, be the best, not just be good. Because good and bad are related to this material world. Day and night, black and white, sukha and dukkha. This is all duality which is of this material world. But Krishna is suggesting to come out of this good and bad, be the best. That's how bhakti is above the three modes of material nature. There are wonderful examples. Person who is in mode of ignorance, he is a Daksha Prajapati. He worships demigods. Means this Daksha Prajapati is one of the example of who was in the modes and worshipping demigods. The Daksha Prajapati, he worships Brahma, his father. And he has a lot of enmity towards Shiva. See, a person who is worshipping demigods, they cannot come out of the duality. They cannot come out of the three modes of material nature. They will act in that way. Even though somebody is worshipping demigod, it doesn't mean that he will get all the good qualities. No. He has the envious nature, he has the proud, all these, you know, bad qualities are still there in a person who is worshipping demigod. So one example is Daksha Prajapati. He worshipping Brahma, but still he has enmity towards Shiva. He is envious of Shiva. And Ravan and Hiranyakashipu, they were worshipping, Ravan was worshipping Shiva, Hiranyakashipu was worshipping Brahma again. So they have the desires to become lord it over, passionate. And they worship some certain kind of demigods. They got the results. But still, they got the results doesn't mean that they are purified. Still, they have all the bad qualities in them. Ravan is lusty. Hiranyakashipu is so proud. If someone doesn't accept him as a god, even his own son, he tortured him a lot. But there is another example which we can take. A person from South India, his name is Tirumal Sai Alwar. He is above the three modes. He is a great devotee of Lord Vishnu. One time when he was just stitching his old cloth, he was Alwar. He is mad about God, no shelter, no permanent house, no permanent assets he has. He is traveling village to village and just doing Naam Sankirtan, glorifying the Lord in every deity, in every temple. Pashrams, he wrote a lot. He is Alwar. So he was walking from one place to another place. One day he sat at one place and stitching his own cloth with a sui daga. And from the top, the Shiva and Parvati, they were traveling. They saw the great devotee, Tirumal Sai Alwar. And Shiva comes and says, "Oh, Tirumal Sai Alwar, you are a wonderful devotee of Lord Vishnu. You tell me what benediction you want." Actually, when Shiva and Parvati was just passing, Tirumal Sai Alwar never focused, never got distracted, doing his own things, you know, stitching his own cloth. But still, Shiva came back and asked, "Tirumal Sai Alwar, what you want? You ask me some boons." Then Tirumal Sai Alwar said, no, I don't want anything from you. Please. I don't want anything from you." Tirumal Sai Alwar is telling to Shiva. And Mother Parvati gets intervened and says, "No, you take mukti. You take liberation. Shiva can give you liberation. Take mukti. You take mukti." Then Tirumal Sai Alwar says, "No, I don't want any mukti." Try to understand. He don't have any material desires. He is not in the modes of material nature. He is not in a duality of this material world. And he is not aspiring for any kind of mukti. That is a devotee. That is a Vishnu Bhakta. Sata eva shanta. He is always peaceful and happy in Krishna consciousness, worshipping Krishna. And demigods worship is actually seasonal. You know, it is a seasonal. When, you know, Ganesh Chaturthi comes, all the Ganesh Bhaktas become so active. Okay, Ganesh Chaturthi is over and they become, okay, normal. When the Mahashivaratri comes, okay, all the people of the Shiva devotees, they become so active. Shivaratri is over, okay, done. Calm, peaceful. So it is a seasonal. When it is an effect in the duration of time limits. And there are some people in South India, especially I have seen, they take dikshas, you know, for 7 days, for 12 days, for 1 month, 21 days, they take a diksha. And they practice all the niti niyamas of that particular demigod. But when it gets over, again back to the same life. He may stop smoking in those days. He may stop drinking. He may stop eating meat. He may stop staying at home, having a sexual intercourse. He may stop all this. But once it is over, again back to the same life. All the things regularly goes on. But devotees of Vishnu, they are not seasonal. They carry Vishnu in their hearts wherever they go. Irrespective of time, place, circumstances, they always meditate on Krishna, Vishnu. It is not a seasonal. They always worship. Just like we are reading, hearing Bhagavatam every day. It is not just for few days. Bhagavat Sapta Agaya, to Sadhin Sunenge, Baad Mein Chod Denge. It isn't like that. It is everyday activities. Mangalarti, we attend every day. So Krishna consciousness is eternal. Even after death, the service and glorification of Krishna carries. And demigod worships, they go to different destinations according to their worship. No, Krishna says, Yanti Deva Vratan Devan, Pitran Yanti Pitran Vrata, Bhutani Yanti Bhutejya. He says, if they are worshipping Bhutas, they will go to Bhutas planet. They will worship the demigods, they will go to demigods planet. But Krishna is making this point very clear. He is opening a space for everyone to get accommodated. Krishna is opening a space to everyone to get accommodated in his world, in this universe. So let us see some basic points. Even demigods also get into illusion. Famous examples, can anybody recite? Brahma getting into illusion, misunderstanding who is he, this small boy is God, Bhagavan. He misunderstood, he could not identify clearly. Yes, thank you. More? Some more examples, how demigods get into illusion? Okay. They get into illusion. Questions we can take at the end. If it is a question. Okay. Yeah, she disguised. Here is the point is, even demigods get into illusion. Brahma got into illusion. Did Parvati got into illusion? Maybe. May not be at this case. Even there is one other example of Indra. Indra also gets illusion. He gets proud. Yes. So there are two examples which I have taken. Indra. Krishna is going to asking Vasudev. Vasudev is preparing a lot of preparations to worship Indra. In Vrindavan. Small boy, Krishna goes to Vasudev and asks. Krishna goes to Vasudev. Nanda Maharaj. Sorry. Nanda Maharaj is preparing for the Indra worship. Krishna goes to Nanda Maharaj and asks. What is happening? Why you are doing all these arrangements? Nanda Maharaj says, No, it is not for children. Just keep quiet. Stay for some time. Then Nanda Maharaj, he saw Krishna is still asking, how can you, even a small boy is also should be respected. In the Vrindavan, everybody should be respected. How come that you are not giving any time for a small child? Then this Nanda Maharaj, he takes time for him. Yes, please ask, what is the problem? What do you want? Then Krishna asks again, why you all are doing arrangements to worship Indra? Then Vasudev says, no, every year we do this. Every time we do this because we are Vaishyas. We are, we are dependent on grains and rains. These rains are provided by Indra. So we show our gratitude to Indra because he is providing rains. Then Krishna says, really, is it mentioned in scriptures? How come you are doing this? Is it mentioned really in scriptures? Is it just you are doing your manmani or is it mentioned in scriptures? Then Vasudeva says, and all the cover, you know, other Gopa boys, friends of Koshan, they say. Then Krishna starts explaining. Actually, Indra is a subordinate. He is a duty bounded. He gives the reins because he is supposed to give reins. We no need for that. We no need to worship him. In fact, I recommend we can worship Govardhan and cows and brahmanas. Brahmanas can do sacrifices, ceremonies, and cows can be decorated nicely and they can worship. And Govardhan, Giridhar Govardhan, who is providing us grass, water, all the required things in our life, he is providing. These cows are eating grass in the Govardhan hill and their cows are giving milk for us. Yes, so Govardhan should be worshipped. This is how Krishna presents. Nanda Maharaj, he says, okay, we'll worship Govardhan from next time onwards. Now we have done a lot of arrangements, we'll worship Indra. Then Krishna says, no, we should not worship Indra. Because Krishna, he saw a proud Indra, demigod Indra. He saw the proud. He wanted to bring him onto normal level. So that's why he took whole task of shifting whole worship from Indra to Giriraj. And he spoke a little bit Karma Mimamsa philosophy. But people there, they have not influenced by the philosophy which he spoke. But they got influenced by the sweet words which Krishna spoke with love. They got convinced with that love. And everybody agreed, yes, we will shift whole worship to Govardhan. So they started worshipping Giriraj. In that way, they worshipped Giriraj. So this is seen by, this is done by Indra, and he got shocked. How come this Vachala, this small boy, is speaking all this, and this all the Rajavasis are following him? Then he got angry and he started calling Samvartaka clouds and seven kinds of airs, because airs and air and rains go together very nicely to create a destruction. So he called, he ordered, yes, please go on, shower, throw the rains. These rain drops were coming like a, you know, sharks. It is coming and breaking everything in the Vrajbhumi. So Indra ordered like that to everyone. And he himself on his clouds, just creating a havoc in Vrindavan. So Nanda Maharaj and all his associates, they saw this and they went to same Krishna. They went to same Krishna. You have suggested us to do this. Now it is up to you. Please protect us. Then Krishna sees this and he goes to Govardhan and he lifts the Govardhan with his left hand. And he announces everyone, please come under the shelter of Govardhan. So in that way, Krishna protects all the Vrajavasis who accepted him, who believed him, who kept a full faith on him. But up to now, all these Vrajavasis, they were worshipping Indra, but Indra could not show any mercy because they worshipped up to now. But just once, all the Vrajavasis, they worshipped Govardhan, and Govardhan is protecting now. Sri Sri Jagannath Baldev Subhadra Mayaki Jagadguru Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. So this Govardhan is protecting them. So there is one more point which we can understand. In the demigod worship, if you do a small mistake also, they get angry. They get angry immediately. But in Krishna's worship, Swalpam Apyasya Dharmasya Thrayato Mahatobhayat, even if you do little bit worship, he gets pleased. So Krishna wants to, this Indra become normal. He is proud of, puffed up. Indra knows that Krishna is the Supreme Lord. Still, he took this, you know, troubling part to Vrajavasis. In that way, Krishna lifts the Govardhan hill and protects all the Vrajavasis. We see Indra also got bewildered. He got proud. And if you see Brahma also, he saw one time, he saw Krishna eating curd rice on one hand and, you know, playing with a flute and with the boys, Gopa boys around him. He got confused. How come the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Swayam Bhagavan, can act like this? Krishna in Madhumangal's mouth. He just pushed. Madhumangal was carrying a chas. Actually, it was yesterday's chas which Sudama brought. Madhumangal took that whole chas in his mouth. And Krishna, he went near to him and just, you not giving food to me? What Sudama brought from his house? What Krishna did, he just, Madhumangal was having a, you know, like this in his mouth. Krishna just pushed with his two hands and whole chas which came out of his mouth and fell into Krishna's mouth. This is seen by Brahma. He is saying, how come my Supreme Lord, is he Supreme Lord? How come he is doing all these activities? Then he got doubt. He wanted to test. Then he separated some Gopa boys from Krishna and kept in the cave. So later on, Brahma understands, he realizes, yes, this is the same Supreme Lord, I have committed a great offense. Then he comes and prays to Brahma, Krishna. So in this way we can see even demigods gets bewildered, confused. Name vidu suragana prabhavantha na maharshaya. Even suragana, that suras, all the demigods, sometimes they get bewildered to understand Krishna. Aham adhirhi devanam, they get confused that Krishna is the Supreme Lord. Kunti Maharani also says, maya javani ka channam, there is a curtain of maya which is there. People cannot understand really. So even demigods, they are into illusion. They get into illusion sometimes. Any other examples? Brahma, Indra. Nalakuvera and Manik is sons of demigods. Shiva gets infatuated by Mother Mohini, Goddess Mohini. Of course, it is same Krishna, same Krishna. Shiva also, one time he has given a boon to, asking his own, you know, Ashutosh. He gets very pleased to his devotees. He has given a boon to Basmasur. Later on, he got the name Basmasur. So he gave a boon, and Basmasur was doing a lot of austerities to get the boon. Wherever he keeps his hand, he should die. And Basmasur decided to try on Shiva only. Shiva ran and ran and ran. He went to Vishnu. With the trick of Vishnu, the Basmasura died himself, trying on his technique on himself. So demigods also get into illusion. And we also should understand, demigods are dependent servants of God. They are not independent. They are not independent. If you see, when Krishna is there in the womb of mother womb of Devaki, all the demigods come and pray to Krishna. They all come and pray. Whenever there is some problem in the universal of fights, all the demigods with Indra, Chandra, Varuna, they all go to Brahma. Brahma takes this appeal to Krishna, Vishnu, who is on Karana ocean. And in that way, Vishnu says, okay, I will appear, no problem, go. Then he comes, he appears, Lord comes, appears. He also orders, you all appear before me, you make sure everything okay, then I will appear. Similarly, when Krishna appeared in Mother's Devaki, all the demigods were coming in the night times and creating so much, some kind of atmosphere. Devaki was feeling this. Devaki was herself was feeling this. So much suffocated. It is suffocating. Many people are there in the room. Even though it is a jail, there are so many people. I don't know who are coming and who are going. All these demigods used to come that time and pray to Krishna. It is Acharyas explained why these demigods chosen this time only when Krishna is there in the womb. Because once Krishna appears, he becomes so busy and so busy. He doesn't have any time that demigods can come and pray to Krishna. So they have chosen this time to pray in the mother's womb. See, generally it is said if somebody is in the womb, he goes through a lot of trouble. You know, he goes through a lot of trouble with the animals, you know, small bacteria which pinches him. He feels a lot of pain. And this with all this pain, he prays to God. He prays to God, please release me. I will definitely do bhakti. Please release me now. But Krishna is not such kind of boy in the womb. He is not such kind of boy in the womb. He is स्वयं इंडिपेंडेंट, ही इज इंडिपेंडेंट लॉर्ड, स्वराट. बिकॉज ही स्वराट दैट्स व्हाई डेमीगॉड्स आर कमिंग एंड प्रेइंग टू हिम. बिकॉज ही इज इंडिपेंडेंट द डिपेंडेंट डेमीगॉड्स आर कमिंग एंड प्रेइंग टू हिम इन द मदर्स वूम्ब. एंड मेनी मेनी इंस्टांसेस वेयर डेमीगॉड्स प्रूव्स देमसेल्व्स एज दे आर द सर्वेंट्स ऑफ गॉड. यस, शिवा when he took up this chance to take the poison in his throat, you know, Parvati asks, how is it possible for you to do all this great wonderful activities? Then Shiva says, I chant Lord Ram name always. That's why that holy name, you know, helped me to carry this poison in my throat. I chant with my throat always. So he also says, I worship Vasudeva. Shiva says, I worship Vasudeva, Vasudev, always meditate on him. And he recommends to Parvati that Aradhananam Sarvesham Vishnu Aradhanam Param. He recommends Vishnu Aradhanam. So in this way, demigods also are servants of Lord. If you see, even in Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna sees all the demigods in the Virat form, universal form. He sees Shiva, Brahma, Varuna, Indra, all the demigods he sees in the universal form. Arjuna witnesses it in 11th chapter Bhagavad Gita. So this is one of the pastime where Samudra Manthan, where all the demigods took real help from Krishna all the time. Krishna was there every time in helping these demigods. That shows clearly these demigods are servants of the Supreme Lord, Sri Krishna. The same Krishna as a Kurma avatar down, the same Krishna who is there on the top for the heavy load, on the top of Mandara mountain, and same Krishna who is helping them outside, guiding them how to do. The same Krishna afterwards appeared as Mohini Murti, to divide the nectar. So in this way, Krishna is also helping. And same Krishna is standing on the demigod side and pulling. So in every, this kind of pastimes, we remember Krishna is helping them. This is all the demigods coming and praying to Mother Devaki when Krishna is there in the mother's womb. And any problem comes, all the demigods goes to Vishnu, Krishna. So they worship. That shows they are dependent servants of the Lord. So another point which yesterday in the purport 1.2.26, Prabhupada writes very wonderfully. By that statements we understand this concept very clearly. We don't condemn worshipper, but we condemn worship of the demigod. Okay? So if somebody is worshipping Shiva, if somebody is worshipping Brahma, if somebody is worshipping some demigod, we don't condemn that person, but we condemn the worship of that demigod. Prabhupada writes in the purport, okay, so the point is, it's not a religious battle for us. As we are the devotees of Krishna, it should not become a religious battle for us with the demigod worshippers. One point we should be very clear with that. And Prabhupada writes in the purport, 1.2.26, he says, highly qualified brahmanas situated in the mode of goodness have no grudges against the mode of worship of the others. They have all respect for other demigods, even though they may look ghastly like Kalabhairava or Mahakali. They have all respects for them. And another point Prabhupada writes, it is for this reason only that candidates for liberation deliberately rejects the worship of demigods, although they have no disrespect. They don't have any disrespect for any one of them. So we request people to worship Krishna, but we cannot condemn people worshipping demigods, because even demigods are also empowered official authorities in the universal government by Krishna. One of the shloka in 4th chapter, Krishna says, there should be a cooperation between demigods and living beings, then there will be a peace and prosperity in the world. Krishna says. And these demigods should be respected. And Srimad Bhagavatam, it makes the point very clear. It never condemns the worship of demigods, but always it keeps higher point, always worshipping Krishna. One shloka comes, Devarshibhutatmarinam Pitranam Nakin Karonayam Runicha Rajan Sarvatmaya Sharanam Sharanyam Gato Mukundam Parihartya Kartyam. It says, you may have many, many duties for your Pitru Devatas, your parents, your society. You may have duties to your demigods. You may have duties towards your own forefathers. But when we surrender to Krishna, Gato Mukundam, when we worship Krishna, Sharanam Sharanyam, surrender unto Him, then all these duties become secondary. So the Bhagavatam keeps this point in a very, very peaceful and wonderful way for all of us to understand. So we should be worshippers of Krishna. We should carry Krishna in our heart, having a respect to all these demigods. Just like one point of time, Vaishnava Acharyas give this example. Just like when a newly married groom, when Bahu comes to one house, she has a lot of respect and love for her husband. But that doesn't mean that she will hate all others, relatives, family members. She will have a respect for everyone in the house. She will serve them so nicely, so faithfully. But she keeps her love and respect, awe and reverence for her husband, very specially. Similarly, we should have a nice relationship with the demigods, having all kinds of respect for them, and we should worship Krishna. That's how we don't condemn the worshipper, but we condemn the worship. But we have all the respects for the demigods. Why? Because demigods are the devotees of Krishna. Krishna has chosen them to keep, to give some post and position to rule and manage the universal government. Even in terms of Shiva and Brahma, they are empowered personalities. They are same Shakta Vesha avataras, Guna avataras of the Supreme Lord. So they should be respected, and they should know. We have Iskan Juhu, backside we have a Mukteshwar temple, Shiva temple. You know, whenever devotees do parikrama, whenever they are doing a parikrama, they do a full dandavat to Shiva from the our campus. From our campus, devotees do dandavat pranam to Shiva, and they continue their parikrama. And every holy dham, Shiva is there protecting that dham. So these demigods are not ordinary people. We should always have a great respect for them. So Krishna, there is another concept we can take. Demigods also directs devotees to Krishna. We don't condemn demigods, we don't condemn demigod worshipper. We only condemn demigod worshipping. Worshipping demigods. Okay? So, why? Because demigods also sometimes they direct his disciples, his devotees towards Krishna. So, there is a wonderful story of a devotee of Shiva. He is worshipping Shiva a lot. Then one time, he has a lot of desires. Yes, I want all the kind of opulent in my life. Then Shiva says, in the dream, he says, you go to Vrindavan, you go to Manasarovar. There is one Baba sitting. His name is Sanatana Goswami. You go to him and ask him what you want. He will fulfill your desire. Then this Shiva worshipper, Shiva devotee, he comes to Vrindavan searching for very Sanatana Baba Goswami, very Sanatana Goswami. He asks everyone. Everyone guides him to Manasarovar. He goes to Manasarovar. He speaks to Sanatana Goswami. I'm a devotee of Shiva. Shiva recommended me to come to you and ask for the boon. Then Sanatana Goswami asks, what do you want? Then he says, I want touchstone. You give me touchstone where I can touch anything and it becomes a diamond, gold. It will be wonderful. Please give me touchstone. So Sanatana Goswami says, okay, you go to the dustbin, you will see a, you keep your hand and search, you will find a touchstone. You take that touchstone. So the Shiva devotee does so, he gets a touchstone. When he got a touchstone, he thinks, he directed me to this dustbin and got a diamond. When he is thrown this valuable touchstone in the dustbin, there must be more valuable with him. So let me go and ask for that. So the Shiva devotee, he comes to Sanatana Goswami back with touchstone. He says, I got touchstone, but I want something more valuable. You must be having more valuable than this because you throw this in dustbin. Then Sanatana Goswami says, if you want that more valuable thing, first of all, you go to Yamuna, you throw this touchstone in Yamuna, then you come back, I will give that valuable jewel that time. Then following the instruction, Shiva devotee does that. He throws and he comes back to Sanatana Goswami. Sanatana Goswami gives this wonderful touchstone, which is Hare Krishna Mahamantra. So devotees, demigods also direct his devotees towards Krishna. There is another pastime of Kalidas, which I heard from Bhakti Charu Swami Maharaj. He says, these Kalidas have another brother, he is a Vaishnava. But Kalidas, he was a worshipper of Mother Kali. And this worshipper, these are both are brothers, they stayed just side by side houses. They have one wall which is separating their own compounds, you know, compound wall. On the top of the compound wall, they have a rose flower plant. This every day one flower it used to give. This is actually the property of Vaishnava, you know, worshipper of Vishnu. He keeps on his wall. Every day he plucks out the flower and offers to Vishnu. One day he woke up very late. That Vaishnava, Vishnu worshipper, he woke up very late and he saw a flower so beautiful, so charming. And he offered in the manme. In the mind only he offered because it became late. So he offered in the mind this flower, Govindam, Govindaya Samarpayami. He offered that flower to Krishna. Okay, the flower is still there on the plant. Then the Kalidas, who is a brother of this Vaishnava, he comes out and sees. That day he thought to steal the flower. I will offer this flower, so wonderful flower, I will offer to my mother Kali. He took that flower secretly, he offered it to Mother Kali. Every day he used to worship Mother Kali with the regulation, completely with the time limits, perfectly he used to worship. That day, when he offered with this flower and some boga, Mother Kali, she was so blissful and happy. She appeared in front of his worshipper. She asked, what do you want? What boon you want? Please ask me immediately, I will fulfill it. He got, okay, forget about the boon. Keep that aside. First question he got is, I am worshipping daily. But why you came today only? Why you appear today only? Then Mother Kali says, because you offered me today Vishnu Prasad, which is offered to Vishnu already. He didn't know that. So then he asked the question, really? Is it Vishnu is your most pleasing Lord? You are most happy with that? Then she says, yes. Then why you don't told me up to now? Then from that day onwards, on the instruction of Mother Kali, he becomes a great Vaishnava. So in that way, even demigods also, they may direct devotees to Supreme Lord. Even there is a one pastime of Jagannathji, who was a Ganesh Bhattar, he's from Karnataka. Ganesh Bhattar, he's from Karnataka. He comes to Jagannath Puri once. He reads the Shastra in Skanda Purana, he reads, whoever takes darshan of Ganesh ji, he will get liberated. Means he has understanding of Brahman as a Ganesh. Even if you speak to any Shankarites, they say, because everything is Brahman, so Ganesh form is also Brahman. So their understanding of Brahman is whoever has a Ganesh form. He read that. So he is very worshipper, great worshipper of Lord Ganesh. Then he comes to Jagannath Puri reading this. Whoever takes darshan of Jagannath, means Ganesh ji, in this area, he gets liberated. He gets mukti. He is traveling to Jagannath Puri. On the way, there are many devotees who are returning journey. They are coming back after taking darshan of Lord Jagannath, they are coming back. Ganesh Bhattar, he asked them, why you are coming back? Then they said, we took darshan of Lord Jagannath, we are coming back. The all glorious Brahman, Daru Brahman, we took darshan of Daru Brahman, we are coming back. This Ganesh Bhattar, he was getting a doubt. Really, if he is a Brahman, he should get liberated, he should get mukti. Actually, this guy, who are the worshippers, they should merge into Brahman. They should get merged into Brahman. Why they are coming back into this material life, again back into the villages? That was a question Ganesh Bhattar were thinking. But still, he forced himself to enter into Jagannath Puri. He entered. That day was Snana Yatra. Right after Snana Yatra, he took darshan of the Jagannath. But when he took darshan, he could not see this. It is not a Ganesh form. In his understanding, Brahman means who is in Ganesh form. Okay, he is a worshipper of Ganesh. But he could not see Ganesh form in the Jagannath. He felt, no, I had already doubt, so it's all fake. So he was starting, he was planning to go back. He went to Alarnath and he was, you know, on the journey back. So immediately Jagannath came in the dream of king. He told, there is one devotee who is aspiring to take darshan of me. You call back to him. So he went, the king, he sent his disciples to send him, bring him back. He came. That day, he inspired his pujaris also, Jagannath inspired his pujaris also to decorate him in a Gajanan form, in this Gajavesh. When the Ganesh Bhattar came and took darshan of the Ganesh form in Jagannath, he was so pleased and he surrendered to the Lord. And in front of everyone, it is said, in front of everyone, the Ganesh Bhattar, the Atma, the soul, entered into Lord Daru Brahman. He got liberation right there. That's how every year this is a wonderful decoration which we have. The same thing which we also tried in Bhiwandi, or Shubhankar Prabhu tried, Gajanan form. The same technique used, right? Yes. So this is another pastime where in Chaitanya Charitamrita comes how demigods direct his devotees to Krishna. There is a Keshava Kashmiri, Kashmiri Pandit, right? Keshava Kashmiri, he was Digvijay, he's a full scholar. And he heard in Navadvip there is a one scholar called Nimai Pandit. Let me go and meet him, visit him. So he came to Navadvip. All the scholars, they sent Nimai Pandit, oh, you are a very young boy, you go discuss with him the philosophy. So in that way, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, actually Nimai Pandit, he defeated Keshava Kashmiri first day and prosing the prayers on Ganga, Mother Ganga. Then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, Nimai Pandit says, no problem, next day also we can cover, whatever is remaining we can cover tomorrow also. You please go, tomorrow you come back again. Then when this Keshava Kashmiri slept, in his dream, Mother Saraswati appeared. Mother Saraswati appeared and told, if you see that picture, Mother Saraswati came and appeared. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is none other than my master, Supreme Lord Krishna. You accept him and surrender to him. So Saraswati guides his devotee to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Next day, Keshava Kashmirian comes and surrenders to Sharanagati. He does complete surrender to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. You see, many pastimes like this, the devotees, they procreate with Krishna under one shelter, which is Govardhan. But Brahma, in the case of Brahma, he separated the devotees from Krishna. So when the trouble comes, just like all these Vrajavasis took shelter of Krishna, Vrajavasis never complained, oh Krishna, because you told, we have started worshipping Govardhan, now Indra got angry. So now you have to solve the problem. They never complained on Krishna. But they have taken these difficulties to glorify Krishna and take shelter of Krishna. Just like for us also, this quarantine is also like a difficult time. We may not be doing many things which we are aspiring to do, like bus party, traveling Sankirtan party, going out and distributing books. Yes, going out and meeting people, preaching to the students, meeting our devotees. But these kind of situations, it should give a great inspiration to develop our intensity and Krishna consciousness. Just like Vrajavasis, when the trouble came in their life, they have developed that desire to worship Krishna and glorify Krishna. It is said, when they were worshipping, when they are there under one shelter of Govardhan Giri, you know, some devotees were telling Radharani, Mother Radharani, please don't look at Krishna constantly like that. The Krishna get melt, Govardhan may get melt. So don't do all this now, right now. Some devotees were suggesting Radharani. And Mother Yashoda comes and says, Krishna, you always do this kind of mischiefs. Because you told Nanda Maharaj, so that's why he has decided to worship Govardhan. Now, you see your small pinky finger, you are carrying this so huge Govardhan. Your hand must be paining. So Mother, you know, Yashoda says like that. And Vatu Brahman, there is another Vatu Brahman, he comes and says, no, Krishna is actually, he's smiling, see how he's smiling. And he is not alone carrying this Govardhan. See, all these Brahmanas, all these elderly people like me, who are holding, giving a support. And Mother Yashoda says, yes, you are carrying from so long, you must be feeling hungry. Let us feed some food for you. Then Vatu says, yes, yes, I am also feeling hungry. Let's eat something. So they were feeling, you know, that lovable reciprocation, all kinds of rasas. In under the Govardhan, everybody was exchanging their rasas with Krishna. So in that way, because of that, Krishna never developed that anything against Indra. He loved Indra in one sense compared to Brahma, because he brought all the devotees at one shelter. When the troubles comes in our life, we should aspire to intense our Krishna consciousness practices and services. So with this note, I will end. Thank you very much. Just as a brief, whatever we discussed up to now. So people worship demigods because they are in the modes of material nature. They are in the duality of this world. They have many material desires and they want quick results. That's how they worship bhutas, demigods, who are in charge of those modes. And there is a demigod also. We may not have any direct connection with demigods, but we have understanding of semigods who are popular, famous, rich in this world, who are very popular. So they also can fulfill some kind of desires. We saw the example of corporate company. Similarly, the demigods also can fulfill some desires, but they cannot fulfill the desires of getting someone from liberated from Janma Mrityu Jara Vyadi. They cannot liberate from the person from a duality. They cannot liberate a person from the three modes of material nature. We have seen that. And we have understood these demigods are also get into illusion sometimes. They also get into illusion. We have seen the examples of Indra and Brahma. And we see demigods are dependent servants of God, Supreme Lord. They are not independent. Whatever the results they give, that is comes from Krishna only actually. Whatever the faith also the people have, that also comes from Krishna. They are dependent servants of Krishna. And they glorify Krishna whenever it is required. Whenever they have a problem, they come to Krishna and express. In that way we see demigods also dependent servants of Krishna. And we also see these demigods. We don't condemn worshipper or demigod, but we condemn worship of demigods. Yes, Krishna is offering up space for everyone to get accommodated. If Krishna doesn't offer this space for people to worship demigods, only thing they will become is atheists. They will become atheists. So that's why demigod worship is also Krishna is recommends sometimes. In third chapter, he recommends cooperation between demigods. But on the Lord's level, he recommends for intelligent people, demigod worships is for only for Alpa Buddhis, Alpa Medasaha, and people who worship demigod, they are Abuddhaya, he says. And Krishna is offering that space for everyone. And we also saw how these demigods or favors his devotee, their devotees towards Krishna. And in that way, we have all due respect to all the devotees, members of the society and the demigods. We increase our intensity, just like Vrajavasis have that intensity of Krishna consciousness. Just like we gave example of Bahu, who comes from one house to another house. She respects and serves everyone in the family, but still she have a great love and respect for her husband. Similarly, we should having all respects and humble attitude towards all of these great empowered demigods, we should have a great love for our Supreme Lord, Sri Krishna. Hare Krishna, thank you very much. If there are any questions, comments, we can take. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Jagat Guru Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Grandharaj Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai.